course, for the breakup. So, the lakes, of course, the rivers always break up first, you know, of course, that's what the lakes do. So, it used to be, I suppose, it varied, but let's say, from any time after the middle of April on, and usually towards the end of April, you get your drive started. Depending on a lot of things, lots of people, lots of drives were just on rivers where they stored, some on the river and some on the banks, and they get going a lot earlier, of course, but we were on lakes, our dumps were on lakes. And then you tow the logs down, you'd boom them up in certain size booms, and you'd tow them down to the dam, say on Little Pog there, and then you'd run them through the dam into big down Little Pog Creek through the dams there into Big Pog and then on. But when Big Pog, we sorted them to we sorted the white and red pine from the jack pine and spruce. When the pine got in the river, sometimes we sorted the white and red pine too. But I think in later years we used to sort the white and red pine in the Spanish River, because you never saw all the species together. You saw them separately, because of course they went for different markets. But the drive was lots of fun. It was long hours, four meals a day. You'd have your breakfast at 6 o'clock and your first lunch at 10, another one at 1, and then of course you had your afternoon snack, and then you had your supper whenever you got in. And there was kind of two gangs on a drive. You always had the men on what we called on the bow, on the front, and you'd have, if you're in rivers, that is, they just kept an eye on the river, make sure they didn't jam. Of course, sometimes you purposely put side jams on, you know, to narrow the river and to build up the water and places. But generally, they kept their logs from jamming. And then there was a crew who used to bring down what they called bring down the rear. That is, they'd keep all the logs that were stuck and everything, and they'd just keep moving down all the way, and the bow would be up ahead, of course. So there was nothing too much to say about a drive, except that, you know, you had a lot of improvements to make, dams, and you had to build a lot of side piers. Had a lot of booming to do, and you had power boats. But early days, you used to row. That's when the mosquitoes and black flies eating hell out, and you couldn't even knock them off, because you had this great big sweep, two hands to a sweep, you know, and the 8 men to a pointer. And you'd be towing boomsticks. Mostly boomsticks, because you didn't roll pair booms against the wind, you know, you used to. But you had to get the booms back. And you had to roll the booms around to make a boom out of the big boom, you know, the smaller boom. So it was hard work, but then when you got power boats, it got down a lot, and the men and the hell lot. Yeah, well, the pier, they sorted, that's why we used those piers to hold the booms, because as I say, we sorted the pine down there, and we'd build up the pocket. You'd close the boom off just above the mill across from one of those piers on the far side, and you'd fill that up with red pine, and then the white pine would be floating down going into the mill. Well, then when you fill the red pine boom as far as you could, you swing over, you'd stop cutting white pine, you'd start cutting red pine.
Thank you. sort of wondered, or machine or why. But these just be for the families over there.
They were owned by the that was a company town. We owned the houses, and we had a store there, and big barns, and we kept our horses there all summer while we weren't using them.
Would the families of any of the lumberjacks want to come in and live there, or?
Well, you're like there's a lot of guys like Ernie Costantino and all that gang. They're families. They were. A lot of them were born and brought up there. And, you know, they had big families, like Ernie. There was Ernie and Leo, and their father was Leo. And, you know, there'd be four or five people living in that house who were working for the company. And they got married. They wanted to stay there and work to build a house for them. And and there was a store there, and they didn't. In those days, nobody left the place very much.
What sort of social life was there for
them? We had a schoolhouse, you know, and that was a Saturday night dance, and everybody, Daddy was pretty strict about letting booze in the place, but he wasn't always there Saturday night, so we used to have some pretty good times. And you know, all those people, of course, I grew up with them, and you know, they were pretty good friends of mine.
How about in the bush? Was there any sort of entertainment?
Just what the men provided, and they provided a lot. They bought their guitars and their banjos and their mouth organs, and they'd whoop it up. There was no booze in there, but you know, Saturday, they worked hard, and Saturday night was really the only night that, they'd sing and dance, and the lights were out at 10:30 Saturday night. That's pretty late, because usually they're out at 9. You know, the guys got up in the sleigh hall, they were getting up some of them at 3:30 in the morning, and the rest were getting up at 4:30 or 5. And the cook was up about 2 o'clock in the morning. So, you know, there wasn't too much time for roistering. Sunday, everybody got out and boiled water outside and did their laundry. But Saturday night, they'd be up there